Good morning. Welcome to our worship service today, and our call to worship is found in Matthew 2, verses 2. Where is the one who has been born King of the Jews? We saw this star in the east and have come to worship him. Today is the first Sunday in Epiphany. It refers to the showing forth or the appearance of the Savior to the wise men who were Gentiles. The message is that Christ is for every person, Jew or Gentile. And this is a cause for us to rejoice. Please stand and let us join as we sing our first two hymns, number 53, As with Gladness, Men of Old. Second one, if you would like to remain standing, or if you want to stay seated, that'd be fine too. The second hymn is 547, The Light of the World is Jesus.
To the light. Announcements to go over this morning. Is my mic on? Check, 1, 2. Want me to use a handheld mic? Check. I'll use the pink handheld mic for now. Yes, someone doesn't want me to speak. If it's the end, you're what? Is yours work? There you go. Perfect. All right, just a few announcements to go over this morning. The yellow rose here behind on the altar is in honor of Haven Grace Vatasa, who was born on December 29th, 2020, and she is Carol Jean's 16th great-grandchild, so we want to rejoice with Carol Jean with that. Also, for some of you, you've maybe looked through your old pictorial directory and thought, man, it's been a really long time since we've had a pictorial directory. Well, we're going to remedy that, and we have a new pictorial directory that we're going to be starting. And the dates for that we're going to be taking the pictures are going to be the end of this month, the 30th and the 31st, and also February 6th. So if you are interested in signing up and getting the exact times that you want to come in, you want to contact Glenda Lovedahl, as she's going to be organizing the times for that. Also, if you don't want to be in the pictorial directory, you'll need to let her know as well. Otherwise, we're going to put you in and schedule you to come in. So if you have any questions about the pictorial directory, you can contact the office, it'd probably be best to talk to Glenda. And Chelsea is going to be the photographer for us this year, too. So we're excited about that as well. Also, I know Ronnie has an announcement that he wants to share.
Thank you. Good morning. As you can see, the west side parking lot is now complete. The material came in Thursday, and I was able to come up here and Wednesday, I should say, and Thursday I came up with the Bobcat, and I leveled the loads out, and Wayne went behind me and back-dragged everything, less using a maintainer, so it's got, let it settle out and over the spring. If there's anything happens, we'll fill it in or whatever and maintain the drainage on the side there, but it's there to use.
So one more step closer. Thank you. So I don't want to catch any of you up here with shovels digging up the parking lot. Also, we are excited about the church as it continues to grow and the functioning of it. And one of the very important jobs that we have here is for the sound and the video, the live streaming, to go off well. And as we're continuing to work through things, we always need more help with that. Maybe you're only able to help once a month, or maybe only on special occasions. We desperately need more people to step up and help with that. We need people to help run the live streaming, the video end, as well as those willing to help with the actual soundboard and running the sound system. And you will get trained on how to do that. So if you have any questions or you'd like to participate with that, you can talk to Henry, or you can just let someone at the office know, and we'll get you in contact with Henry as well. Also, looking ahead, on Monday, we have our young adults that meets at 7 p.m. And then this Tuesday, we would typically have our council and deacon and trustee meetings, but they have been moved to this Wednesday. So nothing going on at the church on Tuesday, but on Wednesday, we have a lot of things going on. In the beginning of the day at 2 p.m., circle number 2, you'll be having your Bible study here at the church, and Karen Peterson will be the hostess for that one. And then we have our confirmation class that starts at 5, and then choir will be at 6:30. The youth group meal will be down at the community center at 6:30, and then here at the church, we have our deacon, deaconess, and trustee meetings that begin at 7, and then the full council meeting starts at 8:15. And then on Thursday at 9:30 in the morning, circle 1, Bible study will be here at the church, and that will be a potluck. And then at 7 p.m., circle 3 will be the Bible study at Debbie Iverson's home. So I won't be here at the church this Thursday evening. Circle 3, you'll be meeting at Debbie Iverson's home. Also, if you haven't picked one up yet, we have some flyers in the church there right as you're walking into the sanctuary or as you're leaving the sanctuary right now, and it's for Grief Share. And we pretty much, the longer you live, the more grief that you're going to go through in your lives. We all have different times that we struggle and we lose loved ones, we lose friends, and sometimes it's really helpful to have people to walk through that process with you. There is a Grief Share that is meeting in Stanley, and that's talking about that. Also, if there is a desire among enough people here in Tioga that would like to start a Grief Share group, we'd be willing to start one here at the church as well, but we need to know if you're interested. If you are, you can talk to me, or you can talk to Elaine Nelson as well. Also, we have the fly trip coming up this summer. That's the Free Lutheran Youth in Colorado. It's a great time. We drive down in the 15-passenger van. We stay overnight in a hotel there and on the way back. And it's wonderful speakers. It's a great time being up in the mountains. It's right in Estes Park, Colorado. If you want to look it up, it's a great time. There are sheets in the back of the church also, if your youth has not given you one, or you have a grandchild that might be interested in that, please grab one of those. The best price to get for the sign up, it needs to be done by February 12th, so we have about a month to go before that happens, but it's something that you want to be thinking about and looking at. The last announcement that I want to highlight is upcoming our annual meeting that's coming up January 24th, and that is going to be directly after the church service. We're going to have a potluck, and then after that, we're going to be having our annual meeting. And if you have any reports to get to Barb so she can have them printed up and ready for the annual meeting, those need to be in by January 13th. Are there any other announcements that I missed that we need to bring up? Okay. Yes. Oh, circle 2 is meeting at Carol Peterson's house. Okay. All right. So on Wednesday, you're not at the church. You are meeting at Karen Peterson's house. Good. All right. Any other additions or announcements? All right. For our prayer time, we've got quite a few things to be praying for. We've been asked to pray for a nurse named Bev in Grand Forks, and she has some very serious health issues. Tim Kukuk is in a coma right now from COVID, and it's pretty serious. We want to lift up Tim. We also want to be praying for Lenore Tandy, Lyle Tandy's sister, who's in hospital here recovering from some serious health issues. I also want to continue to lift up and pray for Artis Nylander's family, as she has recently passed away. Want to continue to pray for Jerome Rice, John Walla, Craig Postovitz, and Andrew Rosaka for continued grace and healing as well. Are there any other prayer concerns that we want to pray for? Yes. Yeah. All right. Doug Thole broke his foot, so we want to lift up Doug and his family. Yes. And, yep. And Luis Imsland, Tim is her nephew, so we want to remember Tim. I'm sorry, what was that? Holt. Sorry. I got all these names. Yes. Any other prayer concerns? Yes. Oh, no, I didn't. That's right. Lisa Powers is in need of prayer. I have that prayer request, too. So we want to continue to lift up Lisa Powers. She is not doing well. Any other prayer concerns? All right, let's spend some time as a congregation and pray for these concerns. Heavenly Father, as we look at the chaos that seems to be surrounding our country, it's very difficult to understand even how to pray for our country and the needs that we have. Lord, we do need you very much so in our country. We need you to bring order amongst the chaos and a light amongst the darkness. And Lord, we know that you have given us this great calling to be a light in the darkness and a salt to this world as well. And help us to know how to function, what to say and what not to say as we go through this process with our country, Father. And Lord, we do pray for healing and we pray for your grace and for your mercy. Lord, we also want to pray for Bev in Grand Forks, Lord, who's got some very serious health issues going on. Lord, we want to lift up Lenore and ask, Lord, that you continue to help her to fully recover. And Lord, we pray for Artis's family, Lord. It's so difficult to lose a loved one, especially near the holidays. And Father, we just ask for her family that you would give them grace and mercy. Lord, we pray for Tim, who is struggling right now in a coma, Father, with COVID, and ask, Lord, that you would heal him, Father, allow his body to fully recover. And Lord, we pray for just peace for Louise and her family as they go through this process and watch Tim struggle. Father, we want to lift up Doug, who has a broken foot, and ask that you'd heal him and give him and Kim this special grace, Lord, as they adapt to this new normal. Lord, we also want to lift up Lisa Powers and ask, Lord, that you would heal her, Father, and help her to fully recover. Lord, we also want to continue to pray for Jerome and for John and Craig and Andrew, Lord, as they all have health concerns and struggles and help them to recover, Father, and give them grace as they go through this very difficult time. Father, we pray for these prayer requests and any other that have not been mentioned, Lord, that you'd be glorified and that you'd give us grace and mercy and peace. And we pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. If the congregation would please rise for our scripture lessons. Our Old Testament lesson this morning is found in the book of Psalms, chapter 4. Verses 1 through 8. Answer me when I call to you, my righteous God. Give me relief from my distress. Have mercy on me and hear my prayer. How long will you people turn my glory into shame? How long will you love delusions and seek false gods? Know that the Lord has set apart his faithful servant for himself. The Lord hears when I call to him. Tremble and do not sin when you are on your beds. Search your hearts and be silent. Offer the sacrifices of the righteous and trust in the Lord. Many, Lord, are asking, who will bring us prosperity? Let the light of your face shine upon us. Fill my heart with joy when the grain and new wine abound. In peace I will lie down and sleep. For you alone, Lord, make me dwell in safety. Our epistle lesson this morning is found in the book of 1 John, chapter 5, verses 9 through 13. This is also the basis for this morning's message. We accept human testimony, but God's testimony is greater because it is the testimony of God, which he has given about his Son. Whoever believes in the Son of God accepts this testimony. Whoever does not believe God has made him out to be a liar because they have not believed the testimony God has given about his Son. And this is the testimony. God has given us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. Whoever has the Son has life.
Whoever does not have the Son of God does not have life. I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, so that you may know that you have eternal life. Lastly, our gospel lesson is found in the book of John, chapter 14, verses 1 through 7. Do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. My Father's house has many rooms. If that were not so, would I have told you that I'm going there to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. You know the way to the place where I am going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we don't know where you are going, so how can we know the way? And Jesus answered, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you really knew me, you would know my Father as well. From now on, you do know him and have seen him. Here ends the reading of God's word. Let us confess our faith now as found in the words of the Apostles' Creed. And we confess together, I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated on the right hand of God the Father Almighty, from where he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and a life everlasting. Amen. The congregation may be seated as we continue our worship by listening to the choir.
Into the dark of those stars.
And Lee, I think we have a whole nother set of risers too, don't we? So we could double that out there, right? Absolutely. All right, we'd ask all the kids now to come on up for our children's sermon. All right, thank you. My hand is out. If you guys want, you could sit on the risers, be like the choir. That's pretty cool. Got like special seating for you guys. All right, make sure everyone gets a fruit snack. Beth, could I recruit you to open a fruit snacks? All right, thank you. Okay, grab a fruit snack. Okay, just one though, okay? Okay, Miss Beth over there will open them up for you if you guys need help. All right, so while you guys are getting in your fruit snacks, they're gonna ask you some questions. Do you guys know what a guarantee is? Does anyone know what a guarantee is? Let me see your hands if you know what a guarantee is. Okay. A guarantee is when you're told something and it for sure will happen. Now, what's the problem sometimes when someone says, I guarantee something's gonna happen? Like today, there's gonna be some football games gonna be played. Are any of you gonna watch any of the football games, the playoffs? Yeah, who do you want to win? You don't know, but you're gonna be watching the football games anyways, right? And some people are gonna say, oh, I guarantee this team is going to win no matter what, right? But the crazy thing about sports is sometimes even the best teams lose to what you think is the worst teams. So even though someone says, I guarantee this team is going to win, can we know for sure that team will ever win for sure? No, we can't. That's a bummer. Well, sometimes we get guarantees about the stuff that we buy, right? I recently bought a nice big TV for our downstairs. It's been a long time since we got a new TV, right? So we're really excited about that. And as I was putting that TV up and I was mounting it, I was kind of scared because it was really, really big, right? But I thought, man, what happens if the TV is broken after I get all this work to get it mounted, right? But the good news is it comes with a guarantee. And they call it a manufacturer's warranty, which means that if it breaks within a certain amount of time, supposedly I'll be able to get it fixed. But there's always loopholes. That means that you may be able to say, yeah, I bought this TV and it doesn't work, but they might simply say, you know what, your guarantee is no good because you did something to that TV to break it. And that's a bummer, right? Sometimes, even if we have bought something and it has a guarantee, it's not really as good as what the paper says it is. The guarantee is not very good. Now, and I've talked about this before, how many of you guys have ever used tools before? Maybe gone out in your parents' garage? What kind of tools have you used before? Have you ever used like drills or screwdrivers or hammer? Screwdrivers you've used before? Right, that's pretty cool too. You've used tools too? Okay, but you know what? Some tools come with a lifetime guarantee. You've used a hammer. You have a hammer. That's awesome, right? Some tools, they say they're guaranteed for life. And when I was younger, I bought a whole mess of tools that were called Craftsman tools. As I worked for Sears, and I got a great discount on them, and I thought, these tools are guaranteed for life. That means that if they ever break, whenever, I can go and get them fixed. Now, how many of you guys have been to a Sears store lately? No one? Why is that? Because they shut almost all of them down. And it's super hard to get my guarantee for life tools replaced. And even though people say things like, oh, it's guaranteed for life, or if you buy this, it's guaranteed, sometimes it doesn't work out. And sometimes even people that we know and love and respect will say things that aren't true as well. There's a friend of mine who went to a church that I used to pastor. And when he was a young boy, the pastor was talking about Disney World. And he jokingly told this young boy, I'll take you to Disney World someday. And you know what this boy thought? That this pastor was going to take him to Disney World someday. And he could have, but he never did. And this pastor didn't think anything of it. And many years went by, and eventually this young boy said, you know, Pastor, you told me a long time ago that you'd take me to Disney World, and you never did. And the pastor felt really bad because he was joking, and this young boy didn't know it. And yet,
when a grown-up tells us something, and we assume it's going to be true and that it's guaranteed as well. My point is that there's a lot of guarantees in life that let us down. But you know what? There's a guarantee that God gives us that no matter what will come true. Do any of you know any of those guarantees? One of the greatest guarantees. Yes. What's one of those guarantees? Yes, going to heaven. Yes. Oh, thank you. One of those guarantees is, in fact, God tells us that we will have eternal life. And that guarantee is so much better than what you'll get at Sears. It's so much better if you buy a brand new TV, right? And it's so much better than even what any human can simply say and say, oh yeah, I guarantee this is going to happen. Because you know what? It's impossible for God to lie. Now, what I'm going to be talking about in my sermon today is the guarantee that we can know for sure that when we die, that we're going to go to heaven. The sad thing is that we all go through loss. And we're going to see our friends die. We're going to see our neighbors die. We're going to see even our parents and our siblings perhaps die, right? And that's really, really sad. But the good news is God says that he guarantees that when we die, we can go with him in heaven, right? And I want you guys to hold on to that guarantee and know for sure that you also can know that you'll go to heaven and be with God. Now, who knows, real quickly, how we can know for sure we're going to go to heaven. What do we have to do? Yes. Well, that's it. We just have to believe in Jesus. We have to have faith in Jesus. And when we have faith in Jesus, we for sure are going to heaven. Yes. All right. Well, thanks a lot, guys. You can all sit down. Heavenly Father, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of every present heart be acceptable to you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Most people enjoy a good mystery. Whether we see a good mystery or watch a good mystery on a television or watch a movie, or maybe we play a game that involves a mystery. Although I like good mysteries, I hate the game Clue. I don't know if you guys are like that at all or not, but my kids have always liked to play Clue. I can never really figure out the mystery of who was in there. Or sometimes we just try to solve a puzzle. Generally speaking, I think most people like a good mystery. Mysteries have an attraction for most of us. And there have been some really great mysteries through the times. I think back to when I was a kid, and many, at least from my perspective as a child, used to wonder, are there aliens in outer space? You know, I used to look out in the sky and see lights and say, Mom, there's a UFO up there. She said, no, hon, that's just the blinking light from a tower up there. But I was convinced it was a UFO. And movies like Close Encounters of the Third Kind, or E.T., or so many other of these older movies would have such an attraction to me, and I think many other people, because we wonder, are there aliens? The Bermuda Triangle is another modern mystery that a lot of people wonder about. It's a location in the ocean where seemingly very strange events have happened, which have led to the disappearances of planes and boats, and seemingly on a regular basis. Some have devoted their lives to mysteries that involve finding a lost treasure or finding a sunken vessel. I mean, after all, what mystery is better than one that has a literal pot of gold at the end of it? Well, for the next few weeks, I'm going to be preaching a brand new sermon series on a mystery that has literally touched every human being one way or another. The mystery that I'm going to be devoting my next sermon series to is the mystery of death. Now, I know some of you are like, oh, pop a pin in your balloon, right? You kind of feel deflated. You think, man, that's not a real fun topic. I don't want to listen to a sermon series on death. I mean, frankly, it's something that we all face, though, isn't it? And it's something that's inevitable for all of us
And yet, as inevitable as it is, so many of us just don't want to think about it. We want to push it to the corner of our mind and only want to think about it when we absolutely have to, when we get that call that our friend or relative or neighbor has passed away, and then we've got to put on nice clothes and go down to the funeral home or the church. Maybe we don't want to think about it because it's depressing. Or maybe it just brings up hard feelings that we haven't really dealt with about death because, frankly, it makes us feel horrible. Well, whatever the reason people have for shying away from talking about death, I believe that we should be talking about it, especially since we as a people have something to say about death. It's something we're all going to face, and because of what God has revealed to us in His Word, we can speak authoritatively to it. There are some questions about death and about life that we won't fully understand. There are some things that the Bible is not clear on. And while I will be addressing some of those in this series as well, when we come across those questions, we can speculate and we can wonder and we can look at the nature of God and make speculations, but we cannot speak decisively on those. In those instances, we need to be okay with the mystery that God has left with us of this unknown. However, there are many questions about death that the Bible is very clear on. There are many things that we can know because God has revealed to us in His Word. And my prayer is that all of us will be better prepared for our death as well as the death of our loved ones after going through this series. There is much in our world as well as our country that causes stress and uncertainty. How we face our death and the death of our loved ones does not need to be one of them. So to begin our series, I'm going to be focusing on how the Bible makes it abundantly clear that we can have peace and we can have assurance that when we breathe our last breath, that we will know beyond any shadow of doubt that we have a heavenly home waiting for us with God. Because frankly, Christians as well as many non-Christians have this belief that when we die, we're all going to go to a better place. We have different words for those places. Some call it nirvana, some call it heaven, some call it who knows what. But the real question is, how can we know? Are those people that are not believers, are they correct? Do we all go to heaven? Can we know for certain about this? How can you know beyond any shadow of a doubt that when you breathe your last breath, that when your heart stops and your brain activity ceases, that you will indeed be in a better place? This is the most fundamental question that we as humans probably have. And the good news is this. In God's Word, we have a very super clear teaching. If you'd like to open your Bibles, I'm going to be preaching from the book of 1 John chapter 5, verses 9 through 13. I'll reread it. We accept human testimony, but God's testimony is greater because it is the testimony of God which He has given about His Son. Whoever believes in the Son of God accepts this testimony. Whoever does not believe God has made Him out to be a liar because they have not believed the testimony that God has given about His Son. And this is the testimony. God has given us eternal life, and this life is in His Son. Whoever has the Son has life, and whoever does not have the Son of God does not have life. I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, so that you may know that you have eternal life. You know, starting back on verse 9, we see this odd focus on perhaps a strange word. The word is testimony. God tells us in His Word how we commonly accept human testimony. That means that when someone tells us something, we generally accept it as being correct. When we listen to the weather on the news, we accept that the meteorologist is saying what he's saying, and he or she says that if it's going to rain, it probably will rain. We are trusting on their prediction based on their understanding of weather patterns and what they see. However, sometimes even the best meteorologists get it wrong. Just ask a farmer. They'll tell you.
Sometimes a person's testimony, though, is a little bit more solid than what's going to happen with the weather. Sometimes if we go to a court of law, someone will literally have to swear on a Bible or something else, and they'll say that I guarantee what I'm saying is true. Oftentimes witnesses will be called, and they will give testimony to what they have seen. And these witnesses provide their testimony based on sworn statements. And when this type of testimony is given, it's rock solid. People are sometimes sent to prison for life or acquitted of a crime based on human testimony. However, even sometimes those testimonies can be wrong. The movie 12 Angry Men is a great example of what people struggle with considering sworn testimonies. Sometimes people can be convinced of things that aren't true. So, what do we know about testimonies? If we get back to what the Bible says in verse 9, John writes that we generally always accept human testimony, even though it's sometimes flawed. He then goes on to say that while we do this, we should now even more so accept God's testimony because it comes from God himself. And that God is Jesus. And we know very clearly from the Bible that it is literally impossible for God to lie. God would never mislead someone, and he would never lie. It's impossible. And John writes that if you accept this human testimony, you need to accept God's testimony even more so. It's as if John is writing in big, bold, capital letters, God does not lie. Here it is. This is God's testimony. It's a solid promise. You can be guaranteed that this is legitimate. And John then writes a series of truths that fall under this testimony of God. And these truths apply to all people who believe and accept Jesus Christ as their Lord. And these truths, if you're here today and you're not a Christian, or if you're watching online and you're not a Christian, these truths that I'm about to preach, they don't apply to you. So if you're listening now and you've rejected faith in Jesus, these truths don't apply to you, but they could. Simply by confessing with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believed in your heart. But for all others, for all of us who have faith in Jesus, no matter how great or small your faith is, whether your faith in Jesus is a little baby's faith or whether it's like a spiritual giant, the good news is that no matter what level of faith that we have, if there is such a thing as a level of faith, all of these truths apply to you today. The first truth, Christian, that believers have is the fact that God has already given you eternal life. It's like you already have it in your pocket. It's in your wallet. It's in your purse. You're already carrying this around. Verse 11 begins with these very clear words of truth. And this is the testimony God has given us, eternal life. John is saying, this is what God says. This is what he testifies. This is the truth. You have eternal life. It's not a matter of an open question. It's not debatable. God has gone and done something amazing. He has offered to all humanity eternal life with him. We don't need a question if it's true. Even though God is holy and righteous and just, and he is all those things, he must punish sinners, and that is true also. But God has offered a way for all of humanity to be forgiven, to be cleansed. And the center of that concept, the premise of the gospel, the good news, as we like to call it, is that God offers to all of us eternal life. That means that death, the grave, our human frailties, it means nothing in the big picture because God says, here's a gift I have to all of you. There is but one catch to that gift. This forgiveness of our sins that we have that leads us to have eternal life with God is achieved through only one way. It's like those game shows, you know, where you have like three doors that you can go through or pick one of three curtains. God says, if you want what I have to offer you, there is but one path to it. There is but one door. There is but one way. Listen as I reread all of verses 10 through 12 and listen for the exclusivity of who gets this amazing gift. Whoever believes in the Son of God accepts this testimony. Whoever does not believe God has made him out to be a liar because they have not believed the testimony God has given about his Son. And this is the testimony. God has given us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. Whoever has the Son has life. Whoever does not have the Son of God does not have life. It doesn't really get a lot simpler than that. If you're wondering, what is this door? How is it that Jesus is so exclusive? This is what God has declared. This is what God has said, that it is only through the Son, it is only through Jesus Christ that we achieve the forgiveness of our sins, which leads to eternal life with God. You know, shortly before Jesus was arrested and later killed on the cross, he had his followers around and he wanted to prepare them. In the Gospel of John in chapter 14, which is what our gospel lesson was, Jesus is recorded as saying, you know, we don't have to be troubled over death. I mean, frankly, most of us probably are. We don't like death. We don't want to go through this life missing someone that we love. But if we really think about it, death is scary for us. What's on that other side? And Jesus is saying, guys, don't be troubled. You don't need to be troubled. Now, specifically, Jesus was referring to his death, but I believe what Jesus was saying refers to all death as well. God knows our weaknesses. He knows that we don't like to talk about death. He knows that we grow weak and fearful, especially know that when our end is near. But he says so gently in verse 1 of John chapter 14, these simple words, do not let your hearts be troubled. Some of you listening today are greatly troubled. You see a spouse, a child, a friend getting closer and closer to death. Maybe you yourself have received that notice from the doctor that your end is near, and you're asking that big question, what do I do now? Jesus' words over 2,000 years ago apply to all of us, but specifically you, Christian, who are struggling, because Jesus says to you right now in the Gospel of John, do not let your hearts be troubled. And Jesus then goes on to clearly explain this truth of how we get eternal life in verse 6. Jesus answered, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. There is one way to God the Father, and that is through the Son, which is Jesus. There are no other ways to heaven, although many people believe that. That there are many paths that some people say, well, we sit on the edge of a salad bowl, and in the middle of the salad bowl is eternal life with God, and we all just kind of slide down together. There's a woman in Massachusetts who first told me that one, right? And I thought, oh, that's goofy. That's not what the Bible says. I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Without believing in the Son, you don't make it to the Father. And some wrongly believe that God the Father and God the Holy Spirit and God the Son are three different gods, right? I mean, if you go to India, they believe there's millions of gods. Oh, there are just three more gods out there, right? Or some wrongly believe, well, God the Father, he's kind of a higher God or more important than God the Son or God the Holy Spirit. And Jesus addresses those people also that struggle with rightly understanding of who he is. In the very next verse in John chapter 14, in verse 7, where Jesus says, if you really know me, you know my Father as well. For from now on, you do know him and have seen him. What is Jesus saying? He's saying that he and the Father are one. And sure enough, in John chapter 10, verse 30, he says those very words, I and the Father are one. True Christian faith is believing in the truth that Jesus is fully God and fully one with the Father. And when we have faith in Jesus, we are forgiven and given eternal life. So getting back to our sermon text of 1 John chapter 5, we know that God has given us eternal life, and those that have the Son, which is Jesus, have life. The last truth that I want to share with you today from this passage is the result that takes place when we know Jesus as our Lord. And it's found in verse 13 of our text. I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God. It's as if John is saying, I'm writing these things to just those of you who believe. If you don't believe, this doesn't apply to you. But for all of you who have faith, even the faith of a tiny mustard seed, this is what I write to you, so that you may know that you have eternal life. What wonderful words. So that we can know that we have eternal life. Notice he doesn't use the word hope that you might have eternal life. We don't have to wonder if we have eternal life. We don't have to ask the question, if we have done enough, then we'll have eternal life. Very clearly, so that you know that you have eternal life. You know, an evil trick of the devil is how easily he deceives us. He tricked Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden royally, right? And he has been at work continually tricking and fooling humans into believing lies ever since. When we have faith in Jesus, we are secure in the palm of God's hand. And yet Satan is still out there prowling around, the Bible says, seeking to destroy us. Like a roaring lion, hungry lion, looking for signs of weaknesses. And sometimes when we get sick physically, it affects us emotionally. We've been there, haven't we? When you're laying in your bed and you just feel like, and you start to get depressed, and you start to wonder crazy thoughts. And sometimes it leads us to really go through a dark time spiritually, and we begin to doubt some of those basic truths, maybe that we learned all the way back in Vacation Bible School or Sunday School. Sometimes that stuff happens, even to spiritual giants. And if you ever find yourself or a loved one in a position like this, who is struggling, who is fearful, who is having doubts, we don't need to beat them over the head with a stick and say, you're silly and stupid for believing this lie. But we can gently and humbly correct their error and set them straight. For we are told very clearly in verse 13 that we can know that we have eternal life. We don't need to wonder. We don't need to guess. We don't need to hope. We can know beyond any shadow of a doubt. The enemy may tempt us to sin. The enemy may trick you into believing that you haven't done enough to earn or merit your eternal life. And if that happens, it will be natural for us to wonder, have I been enough? Have I done enough? Have I believed enough? We start to quantify. Have I done it to the level that God expects of me? But you know, I don't ever see that in the scriptures. I see Jesus very clearly saying, have faith like a child. A child just accepts it and takes it. Doesn't question. It's very simple. And one of the most powerful tools to combat the enemy when he throws lies in your face, when you're down and out, is like it's like a spiritual wrecking ball, which is God's word. Ephesians chapter 2, verses 2 and 3 say this very clearly. For it is by grace you have been saved through faith. And is this faith from yourselves? No. It's a gift from God, not by works. It's all from God. It's a gift that God has given us. And we don't earn it. We don't merit it. Your eternal life, your eternal destination in God's kingdom is in no way dependent on what you do. However, your eternal life, your eternal destination is a result of the work done for you by Jesus Christ. And as a result of this truth, we can know that we have eternal life. Furthermore, the good news of eternal life with God is that we get all the blessings that come with it, right? It's not just the destination. It's when you arrive at that destination that life gets great. And one of those blessings is that you have a heavenly home prepared for you already. Jesus says that I've gone ahead and I've prepared it for you. So when your time on this earth is over, you have a heavenly home that's ready for you. Hey, the heat is already on, right? And if it's in the summertime, if there's seasons up there, the air conditioning will be on. Your bed will be turned down, right? There's going to be a nice meal waiting for you because God says in his word that Jesus has gone ahead and prepared a place for us. So brothers and sisters in Christ, to all of us who have Jesus as our Lord, don't fear death. Don't be afraid, because death is nothing but a transition from a life full of problems and pain and sin to a life of peace and joy and sinless perfection. Praise the Lord for that. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, if we're honest, we can hear this message and we can still fear. We still have weaknesses. Lord, you know that we are but dust and that we struggle. And Lord, if there's any here right now that are really wrestling with where will I be? How do I know? Lord, help them to understand the very simple gospel that if we confess with our mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in our heart that God raised him from the dead, we will be saved. Lord, you don't call us to have an understanding of the mysteries of the world. You call us to simply take what you have given us. Thank you for that simple gift. And Lord, as we go through our lives, we will face death. Death of loved ones and eventually death of ourselves unless you, Jesus, return a second time before then. Prepare us. Help us to live our lives full of joy and peace and hope. So that when people look at us and they wonder, how is it you can live this way with the way the world is and how crazy everything is? And we can honestly respond because we know where we are going to go. And as a result, it gives us peace that passes all understanding. So we pray together the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. On earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The congregation, please rise for our closing hymn.
Hymn number 50, if you want to follow along in your hymnal, O God, our help in ages past.
Thank you.
And now for the benediction. Now may the Lord Jesus Christ himself and God our Father, who has loved us and given us eternal comfort and good hope by grace, comfort and strengthen your hearts in every good work and word. Amen.